Welcome back to After the Fact. Unity. That's the lone battle cry of presidential candidate Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr.'s campaign. But it seems that his message backfired over the weekend when his political opponents united and zeroed in on the unpaid estate taxes of the Marcos family during the presidential debates organized by the Commission on Elections. Of course, Marcos was not able to defend himself as he again skipped the event, leaving one podium empty on the debate stage. What does this signify? Is it really high time for candidates to bring themselves together to prevent another Marcos presidency? We're now joined by Professor Julio Tihangki. He's the former Dean of De La Salle University College of Liberal Arts. He's also the author of the new book, Patronage, Democracy in the Philippines. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us again on the program.
Good evening, Christian. Thanks for having me.
A lot to talk about regarding the presidential and vice presidential debates over the weekend organized by the Commission Elections. Let's start with a very obvious development. The no-show of Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. and Sara Duterte. Specifically in the case of Bongbong Marcos, he ignored the debate last Saturday, but he presented himself in an interview with PTB4 with a government official, Secretary Martin Endanar, and a journalist seen as friendly to him, Sir Erwin Tulfo. What do you make of this?
Well, at this point in time, I think it's already a fact that the Marcos campaign, the BBM campaign, has embraced the dictum of less talk, less mistake, no talk, no mistake. So, and they have been emboldened by the latest survey results and has doubled down on their refusal to participate in the debates. Now, I think this is already part and parcel of their campaign strategy. And at 60%, I think they have the luxury to be choosy, no? To choose the debates or the forum that they will participate in. No? So at this point, I think time and not only numbers are on his side. But it would be foolhardy for his campaign to be complacent. No? With less than 2 months, you know, we still consider this an eternity in Philippine politics and a lot can still happen.
So given his survey numbers, his and that of Sara Duterte, can they afford not to actually show up in debates and media forums and just attend those which they deem to be beneficial or friendly to them?
Yes. Of course, it's a risky proposition because the challenge for him really, and you know, it's a fact that he is hitting unprecedented numbers at this point, but there's a danger of overheating. And the challenge for him is to sustain this high number or shed just enough to cross the finish line. But, you know, there are still, 90 days before election day, you know, and a lot can still happen. And if we will remember what happened to Fernando Poe Jr., he started with very high numbers, but his refusal to communicate with the voters cost him a lot because this allowed former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo to catch up with him and eventually close the gap. Now, this is a possible scenario given the fact that we are now seeing a groundswell of support for Vice President Lenny's campaign.
Okay. You mentioned less talk, less mistake for Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. What exactly do you sense here behind this refusal to show up? Is it fear of being exposed, exposing himself to possible ridicule or attacks coming from his contenders? Because I suppose it's also very important. We've been hearing people say this. If you're the survey frontrunner, at the very least, people deserve to know your detailed platform and you should be able to defend it.
Absolutely. You know, if he was like the politician that his father was. No, his father was never afraid to face his enemies. No, he would even challenge his enemies to debates. No, but unfortunately, he's not like his father. So I think he was traumatized by his experience in the 2016 vice presidential election, in which all the other candidates ganged up on him, and he doesn't want to go through that same experience all over again. And at this point, you know, given his high numbers, I think, he has decided to you know, as I've said, double down and just not attend any of these debates.
Okay, we also saw some more and more candidates for president trying to take him to task, not just because of his absence, but trying to pounce on him because of concrete issues. We've heard the likes of Ping Lacson, Isko Moreno, of course, Lenny Robredo, even Manny Pacquiao pounce on his unpaid. Ito, factual po ito, hindi po ito yung punto. No?
Right.
Meron po silang hindi pa nababayaran na estate tax ng kanyang pamilya, ng kanyang yumaong ama. Do you think this this renewed offensive coming from his fellow contenders, this could affect his numbers eventually?
Well, in fact, the surprise is this issue came out only now. No, I mean, this should have been raised at the early part of the campaign, and I'm surprised that all the other candidates are trying to take him down only just now. No, it should have happened a couple of weeks back or even a month back. No, but nonetheless, we are here because obviously, since he is the front runner, with those high numbers, no, the other candidates do not have any choice but really to go negative, no, and try to hit him as hard as they can and try to pull down his numbers.
Incidentally, earlier today, Senator Manny Pacquiao challenged Bongbong Marcos to a one-on-one debate. So it's Manny Pacquiao issuing the challenge, and we know how certain people tended to ridicule Senator Manny Pacquiao because supposedly he was not as articulate during debates or forums. But here he was challenging Bongbong Marcos to a one-on-one debate. What do you make of that?
Well, you have to hand it to Manny Pacquiao. No, I mean, a lot of people, as you said, were condescending and looked down on him and his candidacy, no, and never took him seriously. But you can see with Manny the discipline of an athlete, the sports legend that he is, no, and he did his homework. He studied, and it shows in the debates, no. The most important of all, Christian, is he always shows up. So he's never absent. No? So that's the important part. No? And we can even say that among the candidates, Manny Pacquiao, in terms of debate performance, is the most improved player.
Pero nga, what does it say about Bongbong Marcos? Because between the two, mas veterano si Bongbong Marcos as a politician. Pero ito si Manny Pacquiao,
he showed up. Christian, alam naman ni Bongbong yan. No? He will not bite. No? Alam niya all these challenges will only benefit his rivals. No? So I doubt it if he will take the bait. No? And all of these candidates are already throwing challenges left and right, no, to bait him. And, even his sister, his ate, is already telling him to show up. No? So, you know, a lot can still happen kasi may dynamic siyan even sa baba, no? May dynamic sa taas, may dynamic sa baba. And we are now entering the final act of this three-act campaign, no? And ito na yung ora de peligro sa karamihan ng kandidato dahil pag nagsimula na ang kampanya sa local, no? Diyan na magsisimula yung final na decision, no, yung mga shifting alliances and shifting candidates, no. So, and this is actually a battle. What we're seeing now is an emerging battle of bandwagons, no. Akala ng Marcos camp that they already had the bandwagon effect, no, because they managed to score high and given the ground support also from supporters of Sara Duterte and Bongbong Marcos coming together. Pero nakita rin natin lately na nagkakaroon din ng traction tong kampanya ng mga Pink, no, ni Lenny Robredo. So whether this will be enough and Lenny's crowd could be translated into actual numbers in the surveys or whether this would be translated into actual votes, only time will tell. Kasi, sige.
Talk to us about the direct relation or perhaps siguro correlation na lang, no, between the huge crowd attending Lenny Robredo's campaign rallies lately So yung estimate sa Pasig rally was around 137,000 people. Napakadami nun, no? But how would you somehow compare that? How come that is that huge turnout? Hindi naman to specifically lang. I mean, the groundswell that you've been talking about. How come it doesn't seem to be reflected in the survey numbers? Talk to us about the relationship. Kumbaga yung groundswell na yan, give it enough time, can that actually upend a candidate's numbers, especially the likes of Bongbong Marcos hitting 50 and 60, between 50 and 60?
Okay. So I would like to go back to that point that from day one, all of these candidates are trying to achieve a bandwagon effect, no? Which is a projection of inevitability of victory, no? So, the Marcos camp achieved semblance of this bandwagon effect. But now we are also seeing this growing support for Lenny's campaign by this huge crowd. No? So this is actually reminiscent of the 1986 snap election campaign. No? The Lenny camp lacks the same machinery and even the resources as that of Bongbong Marcos. So it's ironic. No? We're even seeing the same clans and warlords supporting the dictator's son. No? And even some former Aquino supporters, no, both mother and son, joining the Marcos camp. No? So, but BBM's advantage was generated through SOCNET or social media. It is now being offset by Lenny's warm bodies. It's this projection of huge crowds is again reminiscent of people power, no? And Lenny's crowd can be considered as force multipliers, no? That will hopefully move the needle towards her favor, no? Now, the greater challenge is to make sure they actually, you know, this crowd actually spread the word for Lenny and actually go out and vote, no?
Pero nga, would that be enough to surmount the numbers? Kasi ang sinasabi ng iba, siguro between 50 and 60% ng numbers si Bongbong Marcos as of the last surveys noong February. Itong groundswell na to, if this continues to snowball on the part of Lenny Robredo, would this be enough to somehow reverse the tide? Kasi pwede, hindi mo nang pwedeng sabihin na lahat ng mga survey firms na yan. Nag-imbento or sinungaling.
Siyempre.
No? So some are more reliable than the others.
Right.
But the point is misleading.
Tignan lang natin yung mga reliable. No? And hindi naman tayo, survey deniers, no? Patuloy na iba dyan. Naniniwala tayo sa science and sa statistics at ng survey, no? So, we take the numbers for what it is, no? As we usually say, no? It's a snapshot of a particular moment in time. At this point in time, no? Ganyan yung numero. Pero, yung numerong nakita natin lately, hindi pa niya nakaka-capture yung recent events like this, no? So ang kailangan malaman natin kung ito ay makaka-capture sa susunod na round ng survey, which is
March,
no? So ngayon ang nakikita natin, is it enough? No, kasi pag samasamahin mo man yung mga numero ng iba, hindi pa rin aabot dun sa numero ng frontrunner, no? So kailangan may mangyari, no? Ano itong dapat na mangyari, no? Dapat yung end game, no? I'm looking at 4 end game scenarios, Christian, no? Kung paano, how this will play out eventually, no? The first is I think, no, if BBM will succeed in maintaining his numbers, no, he will just cruise to victory, no? And history is on his side, no? Because in 3 out of 5 post-Marcos presidential elections, the frontrunner ended up winning, no? FBR in 92, ERAP in 98, and Noynoy in 2010, no? So that's scenario one. Scenario two would be like Lenny will be able to close the gap and eke out a from behind victory, either Lenny or even Isko, no? Similar to GMA versus FPJ in 2004 or even Duterte in 2016. A third scenario would be Duterte's endorsement, no? will be an ultimate game changer, no? Similar to Cory's endorsement of FBR in 92, no?
Yeah.
So, but in typical Duterte style, no, hindi naman tayo sigurado kung talaga merong endorsement o wala, no? Baka ginagamit lang niya itong leverage to get some concession out of the Marcos camp, no? And the last scenario that some people are hoping for, and you mentioned it in your earlier interview with Professor Walden, is the possibility of a united force, no? A united force versus the UNITY, no? If one or most of the candidates will rally around the strongest candidate to defeat the Marcos Duterte tandem. So these are four possible scenarios.
Okay. A lot to digest. Pero dun tayo sa more complicated. Okay?
Right.
Yung united force versus UNITY, would that even make sense at this stage?
In the past, I've always said that that moment has passed, no? That ship has sailed, no? But then again, given the imminent, no, the possibility of a Marcos Duterte victory, no, I think some of the candidates are already thinking along this line, no? So they're just waiting for the right moment or the right opportunity to negotiate for concessions, no? But then again, I've always maintained that politicians are also creatures of habit, no? So their pursuit of self-interest, no, or what we call in social science as prisoner's dilemma, they all think they can win, no? And this idea that they can win by themselves, no, will eventually lead to their loss, no? But okay, there's also that win-win solution that if they come out with an optimal strategy in which concessions are given and taken, then perhaps they can rally around a united candidate.
With the formula proposed by or mentioned by Ping Lacson last year during the initial stages of the unification talks, do you think that would still make sense now? Kasi yung pinakamataas sa survey ngayon, all else rally behind him or her. So in this case, si Leni Robredo.
Yeah, I mean, now they can revive that proposal, and that's a fair and possible formula for unification. But this time, let the candidates talk among themselves. No, wala na mga forces dyan na mag-negotiate pa on their behalf. No, let them negotiate among themselves. No, and come out with a concession.
Let's talk about Isko Moreno. The signs are pretty obvious over the past several weeks, no? So I don't know whether you agree, pero to some, this is pretty obvious. He's trying to court the Duterte support. And in fact, nasa campaign team niya na ngayon, di ba? Supporter na niya si Moca Uson.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned a third scenario in the four endgame scenarios that you mentioned, Duterte's endorsement. Mm-hmm. Do you think that would really be enough, let's say, to shift the balance? And perhaps to make Isko Moreno win?
Well, first of all, no, Duterte's endorsement, according to one, I'm not sure which survey firm said it, no, is tantamount to what? Almost 30%? No? His endorsement is only second to that of Grace Poe. The third is actually Chris Aquino, no? And the fourth is Angel Locsino in one survey I've seen. No? So, the president is still quite popular, no? And his endorsement is also still a very solid political capital, no, to rely on. Second, of course, the endorsement comes with the machinery, no? Not only that of the administration party, but the entire government infrastructure, no? That can be mobilized for a candidate. So this is reminiscent also of the endorsement of FBR, the endorsement of Cory Aquino towards FBR, no, which actually paved the way for FBR's victory in 92. But that was the only and last time that a presidential endorsement resulted in victory. No, succeeding presidential endorsements did not matter. No?
Oh,
now,
exactly.
For Mayor Isko, he has encountered, his attempt to occupy the political center, as he calls it, no, neither admin nor opposition has muddled his narrative, no, and you know, right now he is behaving more like a political entrepreneur. No, he goes where the votes are. No, so right now, apparently, no, in his calculus, the votes are on the side of the Duterte supporters. No, because first of all, President Duterte has no endorsed candidate, and the administration party has no presidential candidate. So is it but rational for him to do that?
But isn't he sounding desperate doing this?
That's quite subjective, no? It depends, no? For his detractors, that is desperation, no? But for his supporters, it's logical.
Okay, let's go to the other push. Kasi nga, in the Philippines, you don't have tandem voting. We have split voting here. You pick your president, right. So it's up to you to pick another vice president. So right. There are certain groups pushing for Eleni Robredo and Sara Duterte tandem. Does that even make sense to you?
Okay. So the Sara playbook, I call it, no? The Sara play for 2022, no? All of this floating of alternative tandems like Rosa Robredo Sara or Isko Sara, no? In my analysis, will only benefit Sara Duterte, no, more than Lenny or Isko, no, because in all of this, she stands to gain, no, from the additional support, no. But it may also open the pathway to the DDS vote, no, for those who are inclined to support Sara, no, but not necessarily DDM, no, and this is a narrow pathway for either Lenny or Isko to benefit from.
So yung support base ng Isko or Lenny groups could end up benefiting Sara Duterte more
diba?
Than her base benefiting either of them. Is that correct?
Right. That's how I read it, no? Pero it is also possible, pero medyo mahirap, no? Halimbawa, for Lenny, no, mahina siya sa class DE, no? So yung pag idinikit mo yung pangalan niya kay Sara, baka naman may ibang DDS na maging pink, no? So or among their political supporters, yun ang tinutulak, no? Like Joey Salceda and Beng Climaco and the like, no? And even Lucas Rodriguez, no? Yeah. So yun yung tinutulak nila, no? The same goes for Isko, no? For Isko naman, it's solidifying yung kanyang populist base, no, with that of the Dutertes.
Okay. Professor Julio Tihanqui, thank you for joining us tonight. Always a pleasure, sir.
Thank you, Christian.
Before we go, American singer Ariana Grande trends on Twitter Philippines for reposting clips of a recent campaign sortie here in the Philippines. Grande took notice of a viral video showing tens of thousands of Filipinos singing her hit song, Break Free. That's during the so-called Pasiglaban rally of presidential candidate Lenny Robredo and vice presidential candidate Francis Pangilinan. Grande then shared a clip on Instagram to her 300 million followers and said she could not believe it was real. Online Filipino netizens were just as stunned. They dubbed Grande as a certified kakampink, or the term used for Robredo and Pangilinan supporters, even though she did not comment on the politicians. Several users also dared supporters of other camps to claim that the pop star was paid. Some also joked that other international singers might not be as appreciative when they see their songs being used in sorties of their candidates. So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguera. You can watch this episode again on I Want TFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.